This paper, I will focus on one problem that had a particular impact on late 13th century discussions on prime matter, namely, is prime matter utterly devoid of any properties? As we shall see, the question is tricky. If the answer is yes, it is devoid of any properties. How to explain continuity in the emergence of substantial forms without contradicting the Aristotelian principle ex nihilo nihil fit? On the other hand, if the answer is negative, it is at odds with another Aristotelian conviction, namely that matter without form is pure being, which obviously excludes presence of any properties. For someone versed in Aristotelian literature, it is evident that numerous consequences ensue regarding the constitution of material substance from the answer to this challenge. For medieval schoolmen, another challenge was also posed by Averroes, who in his encounter with the problem of prime matter stated that in its very essence, prime matter has indeterminate dimensions that are the common ground for the assumption of substantial forms determining spatial properties of any given composite being. Still, although acceptance of Averroes' invention was relatively common, its application varies substantially depending on the strategy of reading and interpreting Averroes and Aristotle. In Fernand of Spain, as I will show in a moment, we observe the highest possible level of fidelity to what Averroes intended to say, or at least it was Fernand's programmatic intention to stick to Averroes's litera in order to expound its very meaning and show a lack of its understanding among Fernand's peers. So a few words about his biography, what we know about it. The first dated reference associated with Fernand of Spain is found in the documents of the University of Paris on May 23rd, 1281. The rector of the university, Peter de Sancto Amore, complained to the papal curia about the chancellor of the university, Philip, who violated university regulations by allowing a certain Fernand, brother of the King of Aragon, to obtain the bachelor's degree without passing the examinations prescribed by the statutes. Information about Fernand's place of origin is given by himself in the prologue to his commentary on Aristotle's Metaphysics. Fernand justifies his affection for Averroes' thought by invoking the proximity of his birthplace and that of the commentator, namely Cordova. An important piece of information concerning Fernand's activity is to be found in the colophon of the commentary on pseudo-Aristotelian economics, from which it appears that its author was the Bishop of Coimbra in Portugal. This information seems to be confirmed by Konrad Eubel's census of the bishops of that city, according to which a certain Fernand was appointed bishop on August 27, 1302, and died a year later on August 8, 1303. According to the above information, it must be assumed that Fernand of Spain, after receiving his baccalaureate in 1281, most likely in accordance with university practice, received his master's degree 3 years later, around 1284. Fernand's surviving works that we know by Fernand, which are mostly commentaries, testify to his activity in the Faculty of Arts in Paris, most likely to be dated at the latest to 1302, when he went to Coimbra to serve as bishop of that city. So a few words about his works. The first one is Question de specie intelligibili. It's the only work offered by Fernand devoted entirely to the theory of the intellect and the principles of cognition. The treatise is preserved in two manuscripts and has been edited by Zdzisław Kuksewicz in 1977. We also have sort of scriptum economice, the commentary attributed to Fernand, which is an expositio of the pseudo-Aristotelian work. And it survived in a single manuscript in Paris. To date, doubts about the authorship of this commentary have been expressed a couple of times. And on list of Fernand's works, the attribution of this commentary is usually marked as uncertain, although there are several serious reasons, I believe, for this attribution. There needs to be more research done to confirm it. Sententia Metaphysica is found in two manuscripts. Each of them differ in the number of books they contain. In the light of the sources, this commentary appears to be the best known of author's works. The earliest evidence of the reception of this commentary comes from John Scotus, Scotus's Notabilia Super Metaphysica, written in Oxford around 1301. Scotus refers to Fernand explicitly in his commentary on Book 7, juxtaposing Fernand's position repeatedly with that of Thomas Aquinas. Later on, the commentary was also referred to by Henry Barton of Mechelen, Peter of Modena, or Nicolas Trivet. Last of these works was believed to be offered by Jean de Jandel, to whom it is attributed in all old prints and also three manuscripts, including one from 14th century. During my research, I was able to establish that this work is to be ascribed to Fernand of Spain, to whom it is attributed in two of 12 textual witnesses. Preparing a critical edition of his commentary, accompanied by a historical philosophical introduction, was the subject of my PhD dissertation. This presentation doesn't, however, concern specifically the authorship of this commentary and problems with its attribution, so I won't discuss here any details concerning the manuscript tradition or circumstances in which this work was attributed to Jandel and believed to be his works for such a long time. To spark scholarly curiosity, however, I shall mention two sources that constitute a solid backup for identifying Fernand, not John, as the most plausible author of this work. So, first one, the self-references in the commentary on the Metaphysics. So we find four internal references to the commentary on the Substantia Orbis written by Fernand earlier. All these references find their counterparts in the latter work, in the commentary on the Substantia Orbis. Fernand refers to his previous commentary four times in books 7 to 9, and these references concern the existence in matter of the accidents, which are indeterminate dimensions, the structure of the celestial body being simple and devoid of matter, and such subjects that are also discussed in the Substantia Orbis. The second testimony for authorship of the commentary comes from John Reading. Reading is known as the author of the commentary on book one of Peter Lombard's Sentences, lectured in Paris in 1316 to 1317, and later in Oxford in 1320. Reading's commentary reports numerous positions popular in Parisian circles in the second decade of the 14th century, the provenance of which is often indicated in marginal notes. Fernand of Spain's opinion can be found in distinction to question 3, utrum in ordine lentium sic dare tantum unum primum ens. The commentary on the Substantia Orbis is referred to in order to illustrate the view according to which the first mover is not an efficient cause, but only a final cause. That Reading regards this view as coming from Fernand's commentary is indicated by a note written probably by Reading's own hand in the lower left margin on page 382, the Florence manuscript that this fragment you see on this display. So let's move on. Fernand's works have never been dated, which is why it might be in order to summarize what we know and what we might be inferred from a lecture of Fernand's commentaries. So the terminus postquem is established from an indirect reference to the position from the Materia Coeli of Gyrus of Rome in question one in Fernand's commentary. Gyrus' treatise was written around 1287, while in 1288 its thesis became the subject of debate in the Faculty of Arts through Gottfried of Fontaine. So Fernand's commentary must have been written after 1288. The terminus antequem can be determined from Fernand's discussion of the problem of indeterminate dimensions in his commentary on the Metaphysics 12. I'm jumping ahead here since I will refer to this subject in a few minutes, but I think it might be useful to establish a provisional timeline before discussing the trinal contents in more detail. So, in his commentary on Averroes, the discussion on prime matter and consequently on its dimensions is relatively extensive, which is no surprise given the content of the commented treatise, which, despite of its title suggesting the cosmological content, is for the most part concerned with the constitution of material subcelestial bodies. There are two places that require particular attention. The first is the commentary ad literam to fragments from the first five chapters of the treatise, first of the five chapters of the treatise. This and the following fragments are the most representative of Averroes' standpoint and the major point of reference in all discussions of on this subject. Let's for a moment read Averroes with Fernand. The fragments that come from the substantia orbis are written in italics. The fragments from chapter two, as you see, it's in one division it's chapter two, in another it's chapter one. So I want to dive deeper into discussion about the different division of this treatise, as you can see it on display. It concerns the quantity of the material body. A body has such quantity as far as it possesses a substantial form that in turn is divided by its subject, namely matter. For such division, however, to occur, it is necessary for matter to be equipped in some kind of primitive quantity by virtue of which such division would be possible. These properties of matter are called indeterminate dimensions and are the first thing that exists in a subject called prime matter. Broadly speaking, the order in which quantitative determination takes place in substance is that first we have a matter with its indeterminate dimensions, then a substantial form that is introduced in matter, matter that is sometimes referred to as subjectum commune, already having this position to assume such forms. These in turn provide a spatial determination and other accidents that are the properties of any substance being a composite of form and matter. The last fragment that I shall display is of vital importance, especially for the discussion we will later follow in the commentary on the Metaphysics. In this fragment, Averroes and Fernand, after him, introduces a principle that prime matter cannot be denuded of the indeterminate dimensions being the indispensable prerequisite for the reception of substantial forms. If it were otherwise, then dimensions would emerge from non-dimensions and body from non-body, which would lead to untenable consequences. There are numerous additional comments, notanda and integenda, to these expositiones. Before we move forward, let me point to one issue that makes Averroes' theory of indeterminate dimensions seemingly vulnerable. In an intelligentum part to one of the earlier discussed fragments, Fernand brings an objection that reads, since dimensions are accidents and so the existence is determined by form, how could it be that they precede form in matter? So that's a fair point. And the answer Fernand gives here is fully developed in his later question devoted to this subject. In question 6 of his commentary, Fernand asks whether indeterminate dimensions precede substantial form. To make Fernand's standpoint more vivid, I will display his solution against the opinions of other masters from the last 3 decades of the 13th century. Given the lack of studies on this commentary and its author, it may be of value to show Fernand of Spain in a wider perspective as not living in a doctrinal void, but as someone lively engaged in contemporary debates. So Fernand examines the issue from 2 angles. If one understands the dimensions in a simple and absolute way, one must assume that the dimensions do not precede the forms, since the forms are more perfect and precede the dimensions in terms of perfection, via perfectionis. If, on the other hand, we consider the dimensions as indeterminate, they precede the substantial forms causally and imperfectly, constituting in every divisible being a basis for assuming the substantial forms. This solution seemingly represents a development of what Sigurd of Brabant proposed in his commentaries on the Metaphysics. He, like Fernand a few decades later, argues that indeterminate dimensions cannot be understood as preceding forms in a simple way, simpliciter, and in the order of existence, ordine ascendi, since this would be to recognize the primacy of accidents over form. If, however, as Sigurd holds, one considers what is first in matter and constitutes its disposition for being divided, these are the dimensions which are the cause of any further division. Fernand's stance might be juxtaposed with some of his contemporaries, namely Peter of Auvergne and mostly Peter of Auvergne and to some point Giles of Orleans. They both argued in a similar fashion that prime matter, being in pure potentiality, cannot be possessed of any accidents, including indeterminate dimensions, which they consider to be such. For Fernand, on the other hand, the dimensions of a substance should be considered as some undetermined disposition of prime matter, as to deem that they arise from nothing is untenable. Due to time constraints, I won't compare with Fernand Giles of Orleans' contribution to this debate, so I added references to respective works in the footnotes that I will display. Fernand confronts his position and its consequences by responding to 2 dubia in the middle of Corpus Christionis. The first dubium claims that dimensions are not inseparable from matter, but rather arise anew, de novo noviter, at the emergence of each new material substance. The opinion addressed here resembles what Peter of Auvergne claims on this subject in his commentary on the Metaphysics, namely that the dimensions are related to the substantial form as appearing in every material body. This means that forms are not preceded in matter by any dimensions or any other kind of properties except those which belong to the forms and which perish while giving place to other forms emerging in their place. Thus, Peter argues as air perishes, its dimensions also perish, while when fire arises in its place in matter, other dimensions proper to it in terms of form arise anew along with it. Fernand, on the other hand, argues that the dimensions of a substance must be in some indefinite form already in prime matter, as it is impossible to consider that they arise not from the underlying substrate, but from nothing. The second dubium concerns whether dimensions are introduced in matter along with forms as other accidents. This opinion finds its counterpart in an anonymous commentary on the Degenerazione associated with Peter of Auvergne. Its author argues that dimensions emerge in matter with the creation of form as they follow it as accidents and consequently perish with form. This, however, according to Fernand, is not the case, since matter as such is full of potentiality, multa in potentia, which means that division takes place within it, while if the action inherent in matter, such as the introduction of dimensions, were to happen through form, then potentiality would be more a property of form than of matter, which, again, is untenable. Let's move on. The commentary on the Metaphysics, as I said earlier, was composed after commentary on the substantia orbis and few years before the end of the century. Generically, it was intended as a sententia commentary, and indeed, it is the same pattern we find in his commentary on Averroes and in the commentary on the economics, that in terms of approach and style are highly compatible. Interestingly, there is one exception. I found that Fernand may furrow his whole commentary, breaking the pattern and stopping exposition to supplement his lecture with the disputed question. In the middle of a discussion on mixture in book 12, Fernand asks whether substantial form is introduced in matter as it is denuded of all dispositions and accidents. The question is longer than any other in his earlier commentary, and might have been as well an independent disputed question if it weren't so explicitly anchored in this place of the commentary by the author himself. He refers to other fragments from his commentary in this question. So it's definitely, it was intended as a part of this commentary. The fact that Fernand pays particular attention to the subject of prime matter and indeterminate dimensions that he tackled in detail only a few years earlier seems to be explained by the author at the beginning of his question and underlined several times in the course of the discussion. Fernand mentions that among contemporary masters and students, there are many misconceptions as to the status of prime matter at the moment it assumes substantial forms. The predominant idea is that it is nude, devoid of any accidents, and by accidents, in this very context, Fernand primarily means Averroes indeterminate dimensions. To prove the opposite, Fernand arranges the body of his question in three major parts, as you can see on display. The second section constitutes the major part of the body. It is divided into four parts, and in each of them, Fernand approaches the problem from a different angle. We will focus here on parts one and four, which are underlined here. In the first part, Fernand considers the subject of generable and corruptible beings, namely the prime matter. First, he discusses the consequences that follow from assuming that substantial form is introduced in matter that has no properties whatsoever. If it were so, Fernand says that matter would not affect form in any way, since the form does not divide matter and both don't interact. Also, matter would not be divisible and form would not be divisible either. It would moreover mean that form would be eternal and would not perish since it would not be affected by its subject, which is matter. The ultimate consequence of this assumption would be the following. If matter receives form and neither form nor matter is capable of being extended or enlarged, the matter has not much potentiality, known as multa in potentia, which means it would not be denuded of form. To make his argument clear, Fernand turns to two sources substantial for this discussion, meaning the substantia orbis and commentary 63 from book one of the commentary on the physics. by Averroes. Most of these problems you see on display were already, most of these problems you see on display were already covered. So let's look at the second of these fragments, which is the reference of to the commentary on the Physics. From the commentary on the Physics, Fernand picks a well-known fragment that concerns the difference between accidental and substantial change. By this distinction, Averroes explains that prime matter, as such, is undefined, undetermined, and such are its accidents, namely three dimensions that are inseparable from matter and in itself unsusceptible to any kind of change. Such indeterminate dimensions are what make matter prepared for the assumption of forms that determine the name and shape of a body that emerges from a composition of form and matter. Also, these indeterminate dimensions, sometimes referred to as corporeitas of prime matter or primum hille, for all of these reasons cannot be separated from the subject, which is obviously prime matter. Fernand, for his part, lists a bunch of consequences that would follow if the opposite stance held. Two of them are illustrative of his point. The substantial form would not have proper ground, meaning if the matter did not have any preliminary dimensions, it would not have the capacity to be extended by form. Hence, as Fernand puts it, the form would exist in matter as somehow separated. Also, if matter had no dimensions, a form would be introduced to matter not through dimensions, not mediantibus dimensionibus, as it is the case with the sensible bodies, yet somehow directly. As a consequence, such a body would have existence proper to celestial bodies. It would not need matter to become substance. At this point, Fernand's conclusion in this part of the discussion is easy to anticipate. The form is not introduced into matter as being devoid of all accidents, since material forms are derived from the potentiality of matter as having dimensions. If it were otherwise, corporeitas would not be the substantial difference between corruptible beings. But it isn't the case. It's evident from the fact that each sensible body emerges from matter that is dimensioned and form, corporeitas es differentia substantialis eius, quia corpus fit ex materia dimensionata et forma. In the last major part of his question, Fernand revisits some of the problems he discussed in earlier parts, especially those concerning prime matter and mixture of elements. The part with mixture of elements we skipped intentionally. What is important is that he explores here some problems that he did not encounter in his commentary on the substantia orbis. Approaching the problem from a different angle, Fernand refers to the difference between the quantity of matter in different elements, arguing that it is untenable to hold that a handful of water has the same amount of matter as many handfuls of air or fire. Accordingly, the quantity of matter is considered with respect to the object created from matter, generatum, but always in terms of space. Namely, the quantity of matter is related to certain dimensions given by the form, hence the greater the dimensions, the more matter. Thus, Fernand rejects the view that the quantity of matter would be the same in every substance, regardless of the dimensions given by the substantial forms. Fernand does not mention any specific author to whom he might refer here, confining himself at the beginning of his question to identifying the Nostri Moderni Philosophantes as those standing on a position that differs from what he defends. His interest in reaffirming the spatial character of indeterminate dimensions suggests, though, that Fernand is undermining here the key concept championed by Giles of Rome, namely the independence of indeterminate dimensions of matter from determinate dimensions given by form. Giles maintains that indeterminate dimensions are not the same as determinate dimensions, namely they do not occupy space, but determine the amount of matter, quantitas materiae in the body, namely whether there is more or less matter by virtue of mass, so to speak. Therefore, a dense body such as Earth contains more matter than a less dense body, such as water or fire, and a handful of Earth contains more matter than a handful of water or fire. In another fragment, Fernand argues that the same amount of matter can exist in both one handful of Earth and hundreds of handfuls of fire, provided there is a form that would give such dimensions to the matter. The quantity of matter itself would remain the same in either case. So let me draw your attention to conclusions that might be derived from the encounter with views that seem to belong to Giles of Rome, or at least have an Egidian flavor. The concept of quantitas materiae was developed by in Giles's early works dating from the 1270s. Nonetheless, there is no trace of its inception in Paris until the early 14th century, which is evidenced by the absence of this opinion in the commentaries on the Physics, Metaphysics, as well as in the commentary on the Substantia Orbis by Fernand. The notable exceptions are the theological questions of Thomas of Satan and Godfrey of Fontaine concerning transubstantiation, which is a substantial change of bread into flesh in the absence of change in accidents of bread. The first author, in his Quodlibet 2 of 1285, refers to Giles's view, ultimately rejecting it in favor of a solution closer to Averroes. The latter master, Godfrey of Fontaine, engaged in a debate on the subject in his Quodlibet 11, dating from 1294, where he amply examines the position of Averroes, which he calls true and rational, and then that of Giles, to which he refers critically. It might seem that this new interest expressed in the commentary on the Metaphysics 12 could be linked to a change in doctrinal interest and to addressing the same problems by Godfrey in his Quodlibet discussions of 1294. Given that Fernand's commentary was already present in academic circles outside Paris at the beginning of the 14th century, it would therefore be feasible to set the time of its composition in the middle of 1290s. As a conclusion of the presentation, I would like to point to one last fragment from the same discussion shortly after critically evaluating the concept of quantitas materiae as related to non-spatial properties. He revisits the problem of generation of the body from non-body, complaining for those who study Aristotle and for some reason believe that such generation is even possible. Fernand immediately refers his students to the commentator, whom they shall read for a better understanding of the subject, since even if the matter were denuded of accidents, there will always exist dispositions in which body exists. As he concludes, I truly believe that they will never find, these students will never find any basis to prove that point, the opposite point, except what was already covered here in arguing for this solution, namely solution of Aristotle, Averroes, and obviously Fernand. So hard to argue with that. Thank you.